Thank you. Thank you, everyone, Sean, Andrew, Meredith, and David for excellent presentations so far. It's been just a very exciting morning, and I'm very happy to be here to share these remarks and also to learn everything I've been learning already this morning. So the remarks that I want to make today arise in the context of work that I've been doing on oil and gas pipelines as media. Now, to describe pipelines as media might seem unconventional, but I think it confirms rather than constrains the substantive meaning of this category. As the noted media historian Lisa Gittleman has written, media are socially realized structures of communication. And in this sense, and this, of course, as Canadians, we learn originally from the great Harold Innes, in this sense, transportation infrastructures are the most, are the oldest and most enduring media, especially if we accept that communication is not just limited to the circulation of meaning via symbolic representation, and instead also includes those forms of organized movement and action by which social reality is built and organized. Transportation is communication, and its infrastructures are media. By virtue of the materialities of circulation and distribution and interaction that they make present, not only or even primarily because of the semantic meaning of their contents. This is my favorite image of a pipeline by the New Brunswick photographer Thaddeus Halonia of a section of pipeline about to be installed in his province. Pipelines, and I'm going to have a bunch of slides today. They're mostly for purposes of illustration. I won't be speaking directly to them. Pipelines accomplish a range of mediatic functions. They contain, they store, they convey, they conduct, they transmit, they connect, they distribute, they span. In all these respects, they're like rivers, canals, railroads, highways, and so also like telegraphy, telephony, portable print media, and wired and wireless digital networks. In none of these functions are pipelines simply neutral. It matters how and what they contain and what they convey, between where and whom they conduct it, for what purpose, to whose benefit and detriment, under whose control, with what foreseen and unforeseen implications. My interests in pipelines as media run primarily to their complex old and new materialities, right? To the opportunities they present for emerging forms of political subjectivity and action, including, for example, for a politics of sabotage. Now, that is a very scary word, and I'm not going to talk about it today. Though I did think about it yesterday as I crossed the border on my way here. They always ask when you get to the border, what is the purpose of your visit? And when you're an academic and you tell them that you're coming to give a talk at a university, they always say, oh, that's interesting. What are you going to talk about? And I've often fantasized about the day that I will answer pipelines and sabotage, but it never quite seems like the right time to give it a try. And yesterday was also not the day, but it will come. Instead, I'm going to talk about recent efforts in Canada to obscure the material and complex material politics of energy pipelines by attaching symbolic value to them. Not only to their greasy and volatile contents, but to pipelines themselves as content. In this case, the content of what it means to be a Canadian. And I refer here to the manner in which certain rhetorics of nationalism, economic nationalism, national identity, and technological nationalism have been mobilized by Canadian economic and state elites in an attempt to manufacture consent for the private appropriation and exploitation of petrochemical resources in Canada, and in particular in Alberta's oil sands. This effort has been concentrated on winning approval and support for constructing the pipeline infrastructure that's needed to market that resource. I want to suggest that presenting petrochemical development, extraction from the oil sands, and pipeline construction as national imperatives that are consistent with Canadian national identity, I want to suggest that all of that is intended to radically undermine the possibility of opening a political space in which we might begin to work collectively in Canada toward alternative energy futures. And I'm going to suggest also that the resilience and breadth of anti-pipeline and anti-oil sands politics in Canada suggests not only that these nationalist appeals are failing, but also that this sort of nationalism, for so long an ideology serviceable to the development of the Canadian industrial and extractive state, might in fact be reaching its point of exhaustion, this ideology. So, following Benedict Anderson, it's become commonplace to describe nations as imagined communities. It might be more accurate to say that Canada was not so much imagined as fabricated, produced materially by means of infrastructures onto which an imaginary nation has been subsequently and repeatedly projected. As Jonathan Vance has written in his account of 12 infrastructure projects that shaped the nation, including the Trans-Canada Highway, Prairie Grain Elevator System, which I've also written quite a bit about, the telephone network, postal and electrical systems, airways and airports. In relation to all of that, Vance says, infrastructure, in addition to its immense practical value, had psychological value. That psychological value accrued to the capacity of transportation, trade, and logistical infrastructure built to support the possibility of national or transnational commerce to mediate a national consciousness, something which Laurentian industrial and political elites were also keen to manufacture. Making railways and highways would be what made us Canadian, Vance says. Building bridges and tunnels was also building a nation with a strong sense of itself. Or as Maurice Charland has put it in his, what I think is definitive account of technological nationalism in Canada, the popular mind, like the land, must be occupied. Infrastructure accomplishes both. Materially, space-binding infrastructure spans far-flung territories and creates a common economic and political space supportive of commercial exchange and capital accumulation. On a discursive level, infrastructure provides a medium for a rhetoric of national purpose and identification that summons collective investment in large-scale technological projects that are presented as coinciding with the nation's interests. This is the recipe for technological nationalism in Canada. The nation needs infrastructure to bind it physically, and massive infrastructure projects that serve the interests of capital need the imperative of national purpose in order to be considered legitimate. Infrastructure is, in this sense, both materially and discursively performative. It performs or constitutes in words and things the nation whose authorization it requires in order to proceed smoothly. In both respects, then, infrastructure as means and end, right, as material and as ideology, constitutes the nation from and as communication itself, as Charland put it. Right. Here again, with communication understood in the richest sense, encompassing both the transportation of bodies and things and the attempted, but often imperfectly accomplished, circulation of shared identity and meaning. So pipelines don't make Jonathan Vance's list of nation-shaping infrastructure for some reason. They're mentioned by Maurice Charland only in passing. The first natural gas pipeline in Canada was built at Trois-Rivières, Quebec in 1853. The first oil pipeline was built at Petrolia, Ontario in 1862. Oil and gas pipelines in Canada thus predate Confederation, right? But didn't really start to proliferate until after Imperial Oil's number one well at Leduc, Alberta, came in a gusher on February 13, 1947. If, as every Canadian schoolchild knows, the Canadian Pacific Railway was the infrastructural midwife to Canada's birth as a country, then pipelines have arguably been the material infrastructure of Canada's unfinished rebirth as a distinctly modern industrial nation. There currently exist over 835,000 kilometers of gathering, feeder, transmission, and distribution pipelines for oil and natural gas in Canada. Laid end to end, that's over 200 times the distance covered by the St. Lawrence Seaway system, more than 100 times the length of the Trans-Canada Highway, and 22 times the length of the entire national highway system. Oil and gas transported by these pipelines, 5.3 trillion cubic feet of natural gas per year, 3 million barrels of crude oil per day, through the transmission system alone, heat the vast majority of Canadian homes and supply over two-thirds of the overall energy used in Canada, including 95% of the energy used for transportation. Pipelines are arguably the most extensive and important infrastructure connecting urban Canada to the vast rural standing reserve of resources that energizes and sustains its economy and its self-image. Debates over oil and gas pipeline projects, including especially the Trans-Canada pipeline, the main line, as David talked about a few minutes ago, built in the 1950s, and the Mackenzie Valley pipeline, first proposed in the 1970s, finally approved in 2011, and still not built, and likely not to be built. Debates over pipelines represent crucial moments in the political economy of 20th century Canada. The Trans-Canada pipeline, the main line, completed in 1958, carries gas over 3,700 kilometers from Western Canada to Montreal. Its network covers a total of over 14,000 kilometers, making it Canada's longest operating pipeline system, the second longest in the world. For some, the Trans-Canada main line remains one of those latitudinal material infrastructures, like the CPR, the Trans-Canada Highway, even some would say the CBC, right, that binds Canada spatially along an east-west axis so that it might be also bound culturally and politically as against the longitudinal pull exerted by the capital, markets, culture, and power of you, our southern neighbors. And so pop historian Peter Newman described the Trans-Canada mainline as being, quote, as imaginative and daring for its time as the building of the CPR had been seven decades earlier. Both became the fabric and the marrow of Canadian life. More recently, former Liberal Premier of New Brunswick and now Deputy Chair of TD Bank, Frank McKenna, invoked this same rhetoric in calling for an east-west oil pipeline to carry tar sands oil from Alberta to the Irving Refinery in St. John, also comparing this project, the so-called, what has come to be known as the Energy East pipeline, comparing this project to the building of the CPR, McKenna suggested that, quote, in a country where gravitational forces often move north and south, a latitudinal oil pipeline could knit the country together both symbolically and economically. In March 2012, then, TransCanada proposed the Energy East pipeline project that would move 625,000 barrels a day from Alberta to refineries in Montreal, Quebec City, and St. John, much of it through, as David explained, underused and eventually converted sections of the existing gas mainline. In the debate over the Trans-Canada gas pipeline in 1956, the supposed threats to Canada's national interest were the American oilmen and financiers who controlled Trans-Canada Pipelines Limited and who represented the specter of foreign control of national energy infrastructure. More recently, it has been the endangered St. Lawrence beluga whales and conditions imposed by the provinces of Quebec and Ontario that have set back TransCanada's plans for the Energy East. And in the debate over TransCanada's north-south Keystone oil pipeline, which we all know about, the threat to Canada's national interest is portrayed as being American environmentalists, radical foreigners, whose activism might disrupt that project's completion. Now, as then, attaching Canadian nationalism to infrastructure development has been summoned in an effort to deliver massive resource rents to the energy sector, wherever they might be from, and no matter which direction the oil or gas ultimately flows. And now, also as then, pipelines have been the object of intense political contest. The epic partisan contest over the building of the Trans-Canada pipeline has come to be known as the Great Pipeline Debate. Describing the episode in his 1970 book, Pipeline, William Kilbourne observed that, quote, the public life of Canada has never seen anything quite like it. At issue was the government subsidy to what was then an American-controlled firm to build and operate a critical piece of Canadian infrastructure. And the creative use of Parliament perpetrated by the government in passing the enabling legislation. The intensity of the controversy was such that Liberal MP John McDougall's death by heart attack in a parliamentary washroom during the final stages of the debate has been attributed to it, as has the health crisis that forced Conservative leader George Drew to resign soon thereafter. In the ensuing election, Saint Laurent's Liberal government lost the election to Diefenbaker's Conservatives. As Newman has characterized it, in the controversy surrounding the Trans-Canada pipeline in the 1950s, the Canadian electorate, which had been dozing for 20 years, suddenly woke up. Diefenbaker immediately established a royal commission to study the export, transportation, and pricing of energy resources and the control of pipelines and pipeline companies, resulting in the establishment of the National Energy Board in 1959 as an independent public regulator of oil and gas development in Canada, whose current chair, Peter Watson, interestingly, is presently on a cross-country tour trying to convince skeptical Canadians that the National Energy Board is more than just a rubber stamp for the energy industry. And let's not forget the Mackenzie Gas Pipeline project, as I said, finally approved in 2011 after decades of contestation, but unlikely to be developed due to the shifting conditions of the North American gas market that David so thoroughly showed us. Changes that have taken place since the time the project was remounted. In many ways, the story of the Mackenzie Valley Pipeline stands as an object lesson for environmental activists and Indigenous groups, and also for industry and government in terms of what I think we could describe as the unstable temporality of pipeline politics, a material reminder of why environmental activists today have something to gain in slowing these processes down, and why government and industry are often so heavily invested in speeding them up. Which brings me now to the burgeoning field of political contestation that has formed around Canada's latest infrastructural imperative. According to the Alberta Department of Energy, only 13% of the world's oil is accessible to private investment. The rest is controlled by national governments. Of this accessible oil, 51% is found in Alberta's oil sands. This, then, is the material fact driving the imperative to develop Alberta's oil sands. There exists in the Athabasca region a massive collective resource that is distinguished first and foremost by its availability for private appropriation. This was confirmed by Jim Prentice, former Conservative Minister of the Environment, later Vice President of CIBC, and now, of course, the Premier of Alberta seeking election, who in 2012 made the rounds promoting oil sands and pipeline development in a series of high-profile speeches, referring to what he described as Canada's enormous untapped resource wealth. Prentice added, "And the best news of all is that all this development can be led by the private sector." So it's instructive here to note that Prentice specifically framed the good news of this unrivaled opportunity for private exploitation of a common resource as a matter of nation building. In doing so, Prentice is just one among very, very many state and industry voices that seek to justify and promote private exploitation of the oil sands by attaching it to a national interest, to a national identity, and to a national imperative. Right? So, for example, national sovereignty, interest, and imperative have been readily invoked to support the proposed Enbridge Northern Gateway pipeline, which, if built, would deliver 525,000 barrels per day from Bruderheim, Alberta, to Tidewater at Kitimat in British Columbia. And also, and you'll see this on another slide, the Kinder Morgan Trans Mountain Pipeline expansion, which would transport 529,000 barrels daily from Edmonton, Alberta, to a terminal on Burrard Inlet in Burnaby, BC, where I grew up. Both of these proposed pipelines, are intended to facilitate the sale of bitumen to lucrative markets in Asia, right? A purpose whose importance to the national interest has been deemed by the federal government to be non-negotiable, right? He says, as against the current situation in which we have otherwise only one customer, which is all of you, at least all of you who are Americans. Speaking specifically of the need to gain access to Asian markets for oil sands crude, Foreign Affairs Minister John Baird expressed the matter quite succinctly. He said, "It's simply not a choice. It's not an option. It has to be a national imperative." Natural Resource Minister Joe Oliver went even further, declaring that Gateway, in our opinion, speaking for the government here, Gateway, in our opinion, is in the national interest, which was a highly unusual intervention given that it was made at the time that the pipeline proposal was still before the National Energy Board. In December 2013, the National Energy Board recommended approval of the Enbridge Northern Gateway pipeline proposal, satisfied that it was required by the present and future public convenience and necessity. That's from its mandate. Subject to a set of hundreds of conditions that the proponent signaled it was probably prepared to meet. Shortly before the deadline for the government's final decision on that National Energy Board recommendation, a consortium of Canadian political and economic heavyweights weighed in with the full force of what I would describe as extractive nationalism. On June 12, 2014, an open letter titled Northern Gateway, a Project for Canada, appeared in several major Canadian daily newspapers, signed by a high-profile group whose ties to the energy and financial sectors were not disclosed. But nevertheless, a high-profile group of 40 former federal cabinet ministers, former and sitting provincial premiers, and several representatives of the business community, including the presidents of the Canadian Chamber of Commerce and the Canadian Association of Petroleum Producers. The letter sets out the imperative that, quote, that as an imperative that Canada open up new markets so that taxpayers get the full value for our energy resources and that our natural resources find a way to those markets as quickly as possible. Going on to add then, with the sort of rhetorical flourish that has become typical of these kinds of appeals, quote, Canada stands on the edge of an unprecedented opportunity, one that promises to strengthen our entire nation. Northern Gateway is such a project, and that's why we support it. And on June 17th, 2014, the federal government approved the proposal, though again, changing conditions in world oil markets and the resilience of Indigenous and environmental opposition, which I'll return to in a few minutes, make it increasingly doubtful that this pipeline will ever be built. The perceived need to attach this rhetoric of national imperative to pipeline projects arises from a second material fact that is particular to the bitumen of the Alberta oil sands. And that is that both its investment value and its exchange value depend on moving it from the point of its extraction to the point of its refinement and consumption. And moving it cost effectively, right? And we already heard about the high cost of oil by rail transportation, right? Moving it cost effectively depends upon an infrastructure that largely does not yet exist. As Christopher Jones has shown in his excellent new book, Roots of Power, the history of energy extraction in North America teaches us that extraction is nothing without transportation. From the perspective of the transnational energy industry and its domestic partners in Canada, if the oil sands availability for private appropriation is the good news, then this is definitely the bad news. Right? And it's bad news because the need to build an infrastructure to move this commodity to market means that what otherwise might have been the methodical unfolding of a tidy little piece of extractive industrial development now must endure exposure to the uncertainties of political contestation. Pipelines traverse disputed territories and waters and habitats that are diversely populated with peoples and creatures and things which have multiple and complicated claims on the impact of those pipelines and the substances that they carry. Claims that place them at odds with the interests of the energy industry. And wherever there is a scene of political contestation, right, as there most certainly is around these pipelines, there is uncertainty, right? And for all the loose talk we often hear about innovation and risk-taking, one thing is certain, capital hates uncertainty. And that's where nationalism comes in. For the great hope is that somehow this scene of political contestation materialized by these pipeline projects can be contained or reduced or managed by attaching the force of national interest, national imperative, and national identity to the project of extracting bitumen from the oil sands. This is a political project in itself, but it is also a kind of depoliticizing project in the sense that it casts development of the oil sands as self-evident, as a self-evident collective good whose pursuit is beyond reasonable dispute, thus attempting to close down the space in which those who think otherwise might make claims to a significantly different future. So the nationalism that's been mobilized by state and industry elites in relation to the development of the oil sands and its pipelines has taken, I think, three distinct forms. The first has been the ongoing effort to represent the economic benefits of oil sands development as significantly socialized. Okay. It would be very difficult to win consent for such an environmentally suspect enterprise if the case rested on the fact that its economic benefits will flow disproportionately to a relatively small number of private corporations, many of which are not even Canadian. This explains the massive effort undertaken by both state and industry to demonstrate the economic benefits of oil sands development and to demonstrate that they will fall to all Canadians, right, in the forms of investment, jobs, and public revenues. In the public discourse of oil sands and pipeline proponents, these benefits are presented as self-evident, right? As an historic opportunity of such magnitude as to place the enterprise beyond the reach of reasonable opposition. This is what has licensed a broad range of recent actions by the Canadian government aimed at reducing regulatory, political, and environmental burdens on oil sands and pipeline development. Recent changes to the pipeline approval process that reduce the range of stakeholders permitted to participate in the public hearings process, and also the increasing tendency of state and industry officials to brand those who oppose these developments as enemy aliens, as foreigners, as radicals, who are a threat to the national interest and therefore not legitimate parties to the conversation. This was made clear in January 2012 when, in a widely published open letter, Natural Resources Minister Joe Oliver accused environmental and other radical groups of working to hijack our regulatory system to achieve their radical ideological agenda. Their goal, according to the minister, is to stop any major project, no matter what the cost to Canadian families in lost jobs and economic growth. No forestry, no mining, no oil, no gas, no more hydroelectric dams. It's interesting that the government would raise the specter of unwanted foreign intervention in domestic affairs by well-funded radicals at precisely the moment that it itself was engaging in a well-orchestrated state-funded campaign to influence domestic decision-making in the United States around the Keystone XL pipeline project. However, despite efforts to characterize the economic benefits of oil sands development as national, the degree to which the rewards of exploiting this resource will be socialized remains contestable. And this is due to many factors. Basically, it's the same story that David told in relation to the numbers projected onto the Marcellus Shale development, that depending on what you go looking for, you will probably find it in terms of revenue and certainly job creation numbers. The reason that these are actually unstable in the case of the oil sands is for a number of reasons. One is the privatization of the resource, the massive presence of foreign capital in the oil patch, the export orientation of the industry, and the underdevelopment of domestic processing, secondary processing capacity. Concentration of benefits in the province of Alberta, comparatively low rates of resource royalty and taxation in that province, the low rate of employment intensity in the energy sector, as David explained, the inflationary tendency in oil-related job creation projections, especially around induced employment, as you've, again, it's so great to have an economist go before you, because then it sounds like you actually know what you're talking about. And the temporary character of energy development jobs. All of these cast the claim that the economic interest in developing the oil sands and related infrastructure is effectively national in at least a contestable light, right? In at least a debatable light, right? The claims about economic developments from pipeline development accruing to something that could be described as the Canadian nation are slippery at best, right? You know, at least if we, by Canadian nation, we mean something other than the carbon energy industry itself. Okay? Never mind the broad set of actors in Canada who don't see their economic aspirations and interests as identical to the fortunes of the oil sands. Even just the reluctance of the governments of Ontario and Quebec to, you know, just lie down and facilitate transport of bitumen by pipelines across their provinces without significant benefit or protection suggests the kind of manufactured character of any purported national consensus on the economic imperative of oil sands pipelines. If there's anything that is truly national about the interests, about the interest in oil sands development, it's the socialized distribution of the risks and the costs, financial, environmental, democratic, reputational, associated with this resource. And so the claim that oil sands development represents a kind of irresistible national economic interest is at least more unstable than its proponents would have us believe. And this perhaps explains why they've sought to bolster it with appeals to two other forms of nationalism, both of which have an established track record in Canada. The first is the sort of cultural nationalism that seeks to identify Canadians with the exploitation of natural resources as the very fabric of our being. Right? This was voiced perfectly again by Mr. Prentice in a speech in June 2012 at a meeting of the Business Council of British Columbia when he said, "We should take pride in who we are and what we do. We extract resources from our abundant natural deposits and rely on the proceeds of those sales to help provide an exceptional standard of living. We are blessed in every sense to profit as much as we do. We do it better than anyone in the world." Now, no one would deny that the extraction of staple resources for the benefit of industrial development has definitely shaped the political economy of Canada and has been intrinsically related to the standard of living in Canada. But expressing this as definitive of our national identity, right, establishes something in excess of asserting this fact of our economic history. It is, I think, depoliticizing insofar as it seeks to foreclose the possibility of discussion about a different country with a different identity and an alternative future. Right. To say that Canadians should consent to a massive extractive enterprise whose economic benefits are concentrated and contestable and whose ecological dangers will be widely shared simply because it is who we are and what we do is to suggest we cannot be or do otherwise. Furthermore, this extractive national identity excludes from the body of the nation all those who have been and continue to be at the wrong end of the political economy that it represents, all those who never did and do not now see their interests and experiences reflected in it. It envisions an identity defined by the exclusion of environmentalists, many indigenous peoples, many ranchers and farmers, many people who live along pipeline routes. The caribou, the beluga, and the orca, our friends and neighbors, all of whom look and sound as Canadian as the next person, but who somehow become not representative of who we are and what we do by virtue of their opposition to this project. And this nationalism that identifies the nation with the extractive enterprise and those who carry it out has been supplemented by a third sort of nationalism, one that's been raised particularly in support of proposals to build east-west pipeline infrastructures that will traverse the country laterally. As I've already discussed, this sort of technological nationalism has a very long history in Canada, whereby lateral infrastructures built to facilitate national and imperial commerce are credited with binding the nation, both materially and ideologically. The Canadian Pacific Railway, as I said, is the paradigmatic example of this sort of infrastructural project to which we've attributed the realization of the nation itself. And technological nationalism of this sort has long been an effective means of collapsing the differences that actually make up the country and orienting these to a common purpose that is not necessarily all that common. The attachment of technological nationalism to the oil sands pipelines thus falls into a familiar pattern, but it differs in a crucial respect. In most previous episodes of technological nationalism in Canada, the common obstacles that had to be overcome to materialize the nation by force of infrastructure were geographical: the country's great expanse, its daunting rivers and prairies and mountains. But these days, the obstacle faced by those seeking to build an infrastructure that will traverse the country to facilitate commercial circulation is not primarily geographical. Right? It's political. Right? The problem is not that the country is not bound spatially. The problem is that As the ongoing contest over the development of the oil sands suggests, it's not bound politically in the belief that this enterprise is so clearly in the national interest and so clearly expressive of our national identity that building the infrastructure to support it is a self-evident national imperative beyond all debate. It's this geography of political difference, not the geography of the land and the waters, right, that the energy industry and its representatives must overcome in order to realize this new national dream. This is no doubt what Mr. McKenna had in mind when advocating on behalf of the Energy East pipeline project that would bring Alberta bitumen across the country to the Irving Refinery in St. John. He suggested that such a project would serve to deflate opposition to oil sands development. A national pipeline, he said, would put the issue beyond dispute. Ironically, I think Mr. McKenna's bold assurance here is actually an index of the exhaustion of the ability of economic, cultural, and technological nationalism to summon the consent of Canada's diverse population to the next great project of extractive industrialism in Canada. This is not to say that there are not some, many in fact, who are still persuaded by the image of endless jobs and public coffers burgeoning with oil and gas revenues, by appeals to a romantic history of a proud resource nation purged of the brutal realities of extractor-settler capitalism, or by the prospect of a nation materially bound against its diverse experiences, interests, and aspirations by a big long pipe that picks up bitumen at one end and delivers it at another. There are probably many people, I think, who still believe in all of this. But the thing is, there is also a growing, resilient, creative, diverse, supranational population in Canada and elsewhere for whom such appeals hold no persuasive force and who are not prepared to sacrifice whatever it is that they actually do identify with: Indigenous integrity, the wilderness and its creatures, environmental and economic sustainability, economic equality, popular rather than corporate sovereignty, right? They're not prepared to sacrifice those things for a mythical national interest with which they do not identify. These people, the borderless confederacy Naomi Klein has recently dubbed Blockadia, are not persuaded by pipeline nationalism, and they will not be silenced by it. The popular mind, it would seem, is no longer so easily occupied. In a 2012 essay he published in Policy Options magazine entitled Energy for Nation Building in the 21st Century, Alberta Premier Jim Prentice observes, "Nation-building projects throughout history have all had their share of controversy and challenge, and today's projects are no exception." A couple of years later, in a 2014 Globe and Mail editorial, former Liberal MP Martha Hall Findlay concurs, saying, "Other major nation-building projects in Canada's history, such as the CPR, the St. Lawrence Seaway, and the Trans-Canada Pipeline, were plenty controversial." What's most remarkable here is not the way in which such rhetoric erases the actual violence, dispossession, environmental disruption, and unequal distribution of benefits that these nation-building projects entailed, but the way that it seeks to reduce serious political contestation to mere controversy, right? As if the future is already written, and those who demand and aspire to alternative economic and energy futures are mere public relations obstacles to be overcome by serious people on the path to progress, just as were the Indigenous peoples, species, and their lands in previous nation-building infrastructure projects. But while the representatives of this national imagination in Canada can continue to be held by imagining a nation without politics, right, the impatient executives of the oil and gas industry themselves cannot afford this luxury. And they're running out of patience with the unfolding failure of nationalist ideology to secure their license to operate. In February of this year, TransCanada CEO Russ Girling visited the editorial office of the Globe and Mail, and he had this to say. He said, "We've got to quit the little bickering that goes on between us and get to the bigger picture and let the institutions that we charge with managing the public good get on with doing the job." Of course, what Mr. Girling calls bickering is what citizens might call politics, right? And what he does not seem to realize is that the public good, as it relates to the extraction project in the Alberta oil sands, has not yet been decided such that it can simply be managed, right? Or maybe he does realize this, which I think would explain the desperation that I imagine I hear in his voice when he goes on to exhort, "As Canadians, I think we should be screaming right now, saying, just a second, are we a resource-based nation or not?" What he must hear when he listens to the people in the streets or on the land or online is that they are screaming exactly this question. They're just not answering it as he would like them to. And I'll stop there.
Call the way, we have time for a couple of questions. Would anybody like to ask Dr. Barney a question about his presentation? Kirk?
Hi. Thank you so much. That was great. I want to build on the question that I had to ask previously, but ask a slightly more pointed question. I think in the United States, we often want to look north and say, Canada should look like the United States, and we forget that it doesn't. It's a very different political system.
Yeah.
And the story that you've been telling now comes in a period when the political party system has really been redefining itself.
Yeah.
And I wonder to what extent that process or process, if I should be Canadian, has really been central or in the background to setting the foundation for the story that you've been telling us.
I guess I want to ask you what you mean about the redefinition of, like, what redefinition of the
party? So the party. We go back from 1993 and the collapse of the PCP, it's reemergence as an Albertan conservative party, the sponsorship scandal with the Liberal Party, and then the sort of the failure of either party really to be able to do what it was supposed to do. The NDP as the emergent temporary opposition party, there's sort of a lot of space has emerged for the political parties and the political leadership to redefine each party's priorities. And I'm wondering, in that context, over the last 20 years or so, we've also seen the sort of global economic pressures, both the 2008 crisis in the United States, and sort of and so forth, then the more recent oil issues. So there has been an enormous amount of change within the political party system of Canada. And this has sort of opened up a number of questions that have been unresolved. These questions are coinciding with the story that you're exploring now, and I'm wondering to what extent that foundation influences the story.
Right. Yeah. My sense is that none of the major federal parties have quite come around to occupying the space that I'm suggesting has now opened up around a kind of reimagination of Canadian politics that doesn't already take for granted these categories of nationalism that I've described, and actually opens onto what I think would be a more thoroughgoing and popularly invigorating, right,
round of political engagement and debate around, well, how do we actually live as a modern industrial nation with considerable energy needs in the face of what is the growing reality of anthropogenic climate change and the rise of complete competing claims on territory and land use that have been legitimized in the past several decades. How do we actually inhabit that political space? My argument is that the old languages of Canadian nationalism, cultural nationalism, economic nationalism, technological nationalism, do not help us, right, occupy that space. The space is being occupied by a large and diverse extra-parliamentary, I wouldn't even call it a movement. I mean, this is why I think Naomi Klein's Blockadia name is kind of interesting, is it suggests the kind of amorphous developmental quality of this kind of extra-parliamentary political energy that I think is growing, not receding in Canada. It can't be dismissed as simply radicals who are naive and who don't get it, you know, who are romantic or something like that. So that space is opening, it's being occupied by these extra parliamentary actors, right? And I have not yet seen any of the major federal parties successfully, right, take the step into that territory and embrace that possibility, right, in a way that that doesn't, right, naively deny that energy issues are very real and difficult issues, and that the Canadian economy is bound up in its resource base, but kind of addresses those realities with a view to a future that acknowledges, right, these other ways of thinking about its possibilities that aren't always already bound up in some of the classic forms of national interest that I described here. I have not seen yet strong evidence, certainly not at the leadership level, of any of the federal parties really taking the step there. I feel like it's just too risky for them at this point.
And with that, I know I said two questions, but one big question and one big answer I think is probably all the time we have. Please join me in thanking all of our presenters.